and that I also grew up in an area, like, I would also write, I'd be coming home during this time living in New York and going to school in New Jersey, and I would talk to people, I would go to the dentist, and the dentist would be like, what do you do? And I'd be like, I'm an actor, I live in New York. And like, ooh, good for you. And I realized that they had, like, they would ask me questions, and I would, like, try to answer them, and it was frustrating to me, and it wasn't, like, I would get annoyed at them, and it wasn't fair, because they didn't really know, like, what my life was like, and I was like, why don't you know more? And then I realized, why should they know more? Because really, like, theater is less of a thing in the South in general. I mean, there are good markets. I'm not saying there aren't good markets and good theaters in the South. There definitely are. There are some wonderful ones. We don't talk about them as much because apparently New York City is the arbiter of all taste. And I became really bitter with that idea that I, as a Southern artist, if a Southern work was gonna be considered a thing that could be produced nationwide, or maybe even back in the South, it was gonna have to travel from the South to New York and then back again. And that made no sense to me, none whatsoever. So I started talking to people about, like, I have this feeling of connection to the place where I grew up. I feel like there's a lot of work to be done there, and I wanna get back there. I think I might wanna move back and see what's possible in a smaller market. What can you do when your concern isn't, when you understand that no agent's gonna come to your show? When I do a show here, I'm not wondering if an agent or producer is gonna happen into my show or come if I invite them and then take us to the next level. I know what I'm working for, I know where it ends, I know what I wanna do. I know what I wanna do with it, and it's all laid out there for me. Not that there aren't other complications and other factors I have to consider of outside perspective, but it feels more driven by my own artistic ethos. And so I wanted to see what happens if I did that, and I was talking to all my friends, because no one in New York is a New Yorker, or very few of them are. I went to a class in New Jersey, right? I was in a school right next to New Jersey, not right next to New York, with 20 other actors, and I think two of them were from New York. Most of the people are transplants. Especially within the arts field. Like, there are a lot of lifelong New Yorkers, but within the arts, you're gonna meet people from all over. And every time I started talking to someone about my desire to possibly leave New York and do this kind of work, what I'm talking about, in my home area, they were like, oh, that sounds great. I've been thinking about that. I want to do that. I've thought about maybe that I could do that at some point. I wanna do it, but I just can't. I was like, why can't you? Why can't you just do that? Why can't you just pick up and leave? It's actually easier. Like, living in New York is painful and torture at times because it's so hard to live there. But I then moved back here, and like I love telling my friends now in New York what I pay for rent, because I live in my own apartment, like just my own space with like 12-foot ceilings, and I love to tell them the details of my apartment and then be like, and this is what I pay, and watch the blood just drain. So at that point, I was feeling like, no, I have to do this. I have to leave. I have to get back to the South and see what's possible there. I don't know if I'm gonna stay. I don't know how long I'll live there. Don't know if it's gonna look like what I expect it to look like, but I'm gonna do it. I wanna try. And of course, it didn't look like what I expected it to look like. It was very different than anything I expected my life would be. But so that was 2013 when I moved back here. And I was thinking, so, within what I wanted to talk about and looking at sort of the guiding questions that Chandra gave me and that the faculty came up with for this class, one of them was like, what's a moment of failure that you realize that you think you've learned from? And mine was, when I first moved back, I didn't work hard enough. Like, I had an okay transition. I lived with my parents for a little bit because it made it much easier, they're here. And I decided, I was like, you know, I want to work here, and I got some work pretty quickly. I started doing teaching artist things, and I was a teaching artist through the Warehouse Theater in Greenville, and I did stuff at, like, youth theaters, and, you know, blah, 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 all that kind of stuff. And I was trying to make my living that way, and it was very hard. I was making very little money, and I knew it just wasn't going anywhere. My life actually picked up when I got a job at Starbucks, sadly enough. But it's true, like, suddenly I had an income, I had a reason to, like, push myself, I had other things to schedule around, which is funny, like, every time I hear someone, they're like, I'm just too busy to do something, I'm like, I don't believe you. I believe that you probably like the idea of being busy, but you're not busy enough, because I've done my best work when I've been the busiest. Like, some of the best work I did was in 2014, when I was working at Starbucks from 5 a.m. to 3 p.m., going to a rehearsal for something, and then organizing events in the evening. Like, my days were super long and exhausting, but I felt so fulfilled because I was doing so much, and I had a structure that I had to figure out how to make work for myself. It was really exciting to, like, have to, you know, structure your day. Every day was this puzzle and this, like, this terrifying adventure in some way. And I really liked that. So that was, I think I, one of the things that I realized then was, oh, that's right. Just because you live in the South doesn't mean you can just make your living as an artist. Just because this place is affordable doesn't mean I'm going to be able to do that. And I think, and that's an important lesson that I've learned, and it's a thing that I like to always tell people because, you know, I think one of the funny things about moving to a major market is that everyone, you know, generally I feel like people's opinion, and my own opinion was, I don't mind being a starving artist. I don't mind living in this beautiful big city and getting to see all this art if it means that I have to live on peanut butter and ramen noodles for a while. I'll do it and I'll love it. But really, I think that most people's idea, and it was mine at least, I can admit that it was mine, was I don't mind doing that until I don't have to anymore. I don't mind doing that until I get discovered or until I'm on a TV show or, you know, until I'm making the, who knows, whatever gets you by in New York, $80,000 a year maybe. You want to have a nice living, like an okay living. But then I realized, I was like, that was my opinion, and that's kind of unrealistic. And I think it was because for so long, even at the governor's school, and I truly, when that bio that I gave says that that's where my like love of theater and art began, that's really true. I went to the governor's school because I didn't like my first high school. That's the reason I wanted to go. I wanted to go because theater was where I found a community. And I felt like I didn't have a place that I belonged in my high school. When they asked me why I wanted to go, that's what I told them. And when I got there, I realized that, oh, this is something that I think is truly beautiful and wonderful. It can have an effect, and I want to be a part of it. Where did that come from? Oh! But even there, even though I respect so much of what they gave me and how they taught me to think about art and what theater can do, I realized that they were still giving me the idea that the goal, the ultimate goal, is to be an actor and only an actor. And I think that that is, one, grossly improbable. Like, I'm not saying unlikely. I mean 99%. Improbable. Because the people who do that are usually the ones you see in several movies. Everyone else is doing something else. An actor who's on Broadway finishes their show on Broadway, goes back to their restaurant job. An actor who's working on Broadway is also teaching at Brooklyn College or Rutgers University or SUNY Purchase and taking this train hours and hours just so that they can make ends meet. And I think it's time that people learn that that's not only okay, that's wonderful. Like, it's exciting. Like, I have learned far more about what I do and what I believe as an artist when I've had to teach what I do as an artist. I never learned so much until I was in front of a class and I would ask them, what is acting? And they're like, I don't really know. And I was like, oh, I don't think I really know. Why? And that it was that point, like, it was that hard time in New York of, like, figuring out why I didn't want to be there and moving back and getting to teach and having to create work that I realized what I love in theater, what I think is valuable. So I would say that if you think that you only want to be an artist, if that's what you want out of your life and you want to pursue that goal, I'm not telling you not to. And I just want you to know that if you have to do something else, that's not failure. That is not nearly failure. Not making it in a city, a huge market, is not failure. It's far from it. It's just life. Because I also discovered that, you know, when we were graduating from Rutgers, we had to do this showcase, which is one of the most ridiculous things you'll ever have to do. You go to a theater, you do like 2 2-minute scenes with someone else in your company. There are a bunch of agents and managers there, and they look at you, and they decide if they want you. Like, there I am, I'm up here as a product. Do you want to buy me? Or not really, do you want to buy me? Do you want to bring me into your market so that you can sell me to other people? Is mostly what that is. I worked so hard at school, and I had trained for so long by this point. So I went to governor's school for 2 years, where I got like conservatory level training. I went to USC for another year, where I got some great physical training, some good acting training, and did a bunch of shows. And then I went to Rutgers, and I trained 4 more years, one of which was studying at the Globe Theatre in London. And I was a highly disciplined, hardworking actor who loved what I did and got nothing from Showcase. No one wanted me. They didn't see what was marketable. And I realized later why. I realized like what I should have done if I wanted to get some attention. But I think what that taught me, and then what I was taught over and over and over and over by watching friends of mine work and try to make it in New York, is that your talent and your skill, especially as an actor, but I think in the arts in general, does not correlate to your level of success in a place like that. It is no guarantee that how good you are at what you do is going to lead to the kind of success that you feel like you deserve. That's just the hard truth. Because just like in any field, because I also learned this moving back here, you basically only ever get work based on who you know. And that can sound really negative, like that. I think that has a negative connotation for a lot of people, and it does for me in some ways, but it's also great. I went from working at Starbucks as a barista to being the assistant director of Hubba because of people I knew, because I put in the work, and because I knew the people who worked for that organization, I'd been involved long enough. I did not have the resume that should have led to an assistant directorship at any arts nonprofit.